the style that Fnatic wants to play in this game. It's like, do we want to try and out mechanic Forgiven, or do we want to try and force them onto utility? It's just the decision that they have to make here, but they will be banning at least one of them away for certain. Zed, Echo banned away from H2K. Once again, reminder, H2K being on the blue side for this entire series, prioritizing their blue side while Fnatic prioritizing red. Nidalee and Lissandra, first two banned from Fnatic.
Let's find out if the next ones are the same. It would be Azealucian if you were going to go by Game 4 standards. Zia was picked as a last pick for Fnatic in Games 1 and 2, and it worked. It will not be available, so no changes for H2K.
And Deficio was talking a little bit about letting the Lissandra through. Lucian has been banned. I still think we're going to see first pick Kindred here. I actually disagree with Deficio on letting the Lissandra through. I think it was too good at allowing H2K to play a fast and loose game that it would force Fnatic to first rotate the Lissandra. And that's a situation where you've given away a lot of your pacing in the pick and ban phase. And unless you can get such a favorable top matchup that it can win you the game, then it's a big risk in pick and bans if you don't over-prioritize it.
And is not picking Maokai or Sivir or Kindred a big risk this game? If the trend is to be believed, it'll be Kindred first pick. Now is where the steals come in. This is what the analyst desk was alluding to. Yeah. Take some picks away from your opponent that are also powerful. And it's not the ones we were expecting.
But the problem is there are still other picks available here. We have not seen Poppy prioritized in this draft at all, this series, but she is still there as a top tier, top laner. And Fnatic have gone all in on saying, okay, Odo, what have you got? What have you got for us top lane?
And with the Trundle being picked up as well, Sivir is still on the table for Forgiven if he wants it, but it depends what type of composition they want to build here. And now H2K kind of discussing this one. I mean, it's definitely taken away one of those picks as Odoan has played in this entire series, but what's for certain is they pick up the first Kindred once again.
Where does the cookie crumble? 15 seconds left on the clock. Again, series faces for H2K.
It's gotta be Braum here. Vanda can take away the Braum. You can either go Braum or Alistar. What do H2K want to go with it? I mean, the Trundle has been locked in as the support here, but you don't want to show too much more. Unless you're that confident in the rise,
wow.
It can be a flex. I'm not expecting it to be. I'm expecting it to be mid for Ryu here. Hide the top lane for H2K. Hide the support for now. Fnatic, what are they going to bring out? They're looking at jungle. Graves has been the pick this entire series.
Yeah, I mean, that's been like, what, their second rotation every single game? Graves, Ezreal now coming out.
Yeah, 100% correct, young Padawan. Graves has been picked second rotation for Fnatic every game.
Fantastic. Apart from that game with the first rotation, Ezreal. So, yeah, waiting on those last two pickups from H2K. Braum would be fine.
I mean, at this point, Fnatic are in such a familiar position. They have an Ezreal locked in. Now, how scaling is their mid lane pick? Into Ryze, where do you go? Do you go early game, put Febiven on something that is all or nothing to win this game? Or do you bank on scaling once again? Try and play something like the Kassadin and play a more passive game.
It's so tough because H2K have shown in the last two games they can play early, they can dive, and they can do it coordinated. So if Fnatic go for that risk, it's going to be a challenge. With 3 seconds left on the clock, the champions that will get locked in for H2K include Poppy and Braum. No real surprises.
But the Kassadin game, keep in mind, was the game with the Lissandra in, with the fast comp that wanted to fight very quickly. In this situation, H2K, yes, they have decent fight potential. They have the Braum, they have Poppy, they have Corki, these, you know, tools that are okay earlier into the game looking at fights, but it is not the same setup as an Alistar, a Lissandra, that kind of setup. And I don't, I mean, there's no spell shield this time for Febby's Cassio, but I think that's a riskier pick than perhaps they need to go for.
Yeah, but what are the other options here? Because Azir's been taken off the table, there's no Zed, and then if you're really looking for an outplay champion who can literally just 1v5 the game and make that star outplay which wins the game, Cassiopeia would be the pick, but we just had an entire game of Fnatic not being able to make that work. Really?
Ooh. It's not locked in yet. It's not locked in yet. I don't like to talk about hovers until it is locked in. And with 2 seconds left on the clock,
ooh,
a collective sigh as Fnatic bank on the lane, neutralizer Orianna, and they're going for late.
Yeah, they're going for later in the game, but look at what they have, though. Maokai, Orianna, Graves. If that combo hits, you win the game in a later game team fight. But man, the collective just sigh, the deflation.
We have the three playmakers. It was like Ori.
Ori.
But no, Ori can make those big plays late game as well, especially with Maokai into the mix. But Fnatic are basically making the statement that we're going to go late, and we're going to make better decisions than you, H2K, and we're going to out-teamfight you.
That is the first Orianna on the LCS stage all year long for Febiven. And we need to see how well he's going to perform with this champion. The Wombo combo, if you get a good ball delivery system with that Graves or that Maokai, it can be game-changing. But I think it's going to be challenging into Braum, into Poppy, into Ryze.
It's hard. It's really hard. But from H2K's perspective as well, I mean, it's harder to get into those fights. They don't have the instant point-and-click CC. There's no Lissandra, there's no Maokai now.
For the last time of the spring split, Prolly and Daylor have shaken hands. That is it for them. It is in their players' hands now. Their fate rests with the teams.
It really does, and we'll find out where the momentum lies. This is for 50 championship points, for third place in the spring split, and once this game concludes, North America will take off with Team Liquid versus Immortal. So hello to anyone in NA, in Mandalay Bay that's busy watching, but now it's Europe's turn. It's game five, and it's H2K taking on Fnatic.
Today, make sure you hit us up on Twitter, hashtag H2KWin, hashtag FNCWin. See where your heart lies. I think I already know the answer. I know where the audience heart lies in this one.
In the heart of the cards. Hey. Febiven and Ryu set themselves up in the mid lane. Crowd seems a little torn between you and NA from what I can hear. Regardless of that fact, no deep wards, all right? No vision being placed by either squad. Fnatic have been the ones that I feel have initiated those deep pushes more than H2K throughout the series. And we'll find out whether or not we're going to have lane swap.
And to revisit the very first set of games from today, the very first game where we were talking about Fnatic will benefit in the lane swap, H2K should benefit in standard lanes for the 2v2. We haven't seen the same impact from that we saw in game one of the day. It seems like Reckless and Klai started to play a little bit better around that in the games that we saw with the 2v2, but still it is that strength for H2K.
And also important to note that it was Trundle in both of those games that, yes, Klai fell behind early on. However, as the match played on, he had pretty good pillar placements, applied pressure multiple times, and successfully ganked Ryu in that middle lane, back-to-back games.
I also like this play. When you have Maokai in the side lane, it means that you can set up the sapling preemptively. It used to be 120, which when you place them down, then you can do it earlier, now that those have been buffed up. And just helping Spirit for his early clear.
Yeah, good guy Gamsu gets Spirit out on the map a little bit faster on, and look at what he's doing with it. Spirit is heading down in the bottom jungle, looking for Jankos, who should be on his red buff right now. We're about to have a smite on.
He's got the timing perfectly down, but Jankos, he
does
no Spirit's here. Q goes down, but you're right, there's no smite. There's no smite war, and Spirit's dragging it back towards him. The patience meter is going down, and it's going to come down to auto attacks. There's the burst. Spirit, he secures it, and now he goes after Jankos. He's going to be backing away. I mean, he's not going to get help from the mid lane, and he literally can't, and Spirit shoves Jankos out of his own jungle.
Oh man, that could prove to be crucial there, because Spirit pushes Jankos so far away. Neither one had smite, so nobody could really take advantage of the early invade off that, but still, that is a big win for Spirit. It all comes from that initial sapling onto the wolves. The three saplings, now it's going to allow Spirit to control the bottom side jungle. We'll drop back for his blue at some point.
And of course, with Jankos playing the day and night champion, the lamb and the wolf. He's had two games where he was a wolf and he was eaten alive, and two games where he turned himself into the lamb and got destroyed. Which one will it be today? Already under pressure from Spirit, Fnatic. Let's find out how they play these Australia lanes. Klai actually moved into the jungle to place a ward on that red buff, so we'll see if there's information provided.
Like, this is just so smart. Like, this is a play they've literally thought about, and it's like, this is exactly how we plan it. Klai, you do this at this time, and then you go for this invade with Maokai. So well thought out. and having something in the bank for game five of this series, knowing it comes down to this game, is incredibly good to flare up your opponent.
And at this point, look at how this plays out for Jankos. He had the Mark of the Kindred on the enemy camp that he can't invade on, so Spirit goes, okay, I'm going to take that. Now there's a ward on this red buff, allows Spirit to know that Jankos wasn't making a very fast play. Vander's going to come and try and ward up just to see if he can spot Spirit out on the way through, but Spirit pulls back away and now is looking for mid lane. But again, the warding from Fnatic is just enough to hold this. Spirit's already done, and he's got the information that he's getting out here. H2K away behind the play. Now they'll see where Spirit is, but they cannot afford to go aggressive on it.
Five games in a row where Jankos first picks Kindred and is the same blue-red delineation. That preparation coming into game five could be reading their opponents throughout the previous four matches.
And the other point from this is now Jankos has been three buffed because he can't afford to go into the bottom side jungle without mid and bot pushing, which luckily for him, now they are. They were not initially as he headed up into the top side jungle, but look at how Ryze is. Febi now needs to push Ryze back slightly, but Poppy is going to push in towards the Maokai. The problem is to group on that blue buff is very risky this early on. You can see Jankos just goes, okay guys, I can't get it. I'm going to have to retreat to my jungle and look to farm this up off smaller camps.
So far ahead right now. Jankos will be getting level 4 off of this, and the Spirit is like a full half level ahead, if not a little bit more. And you can see the gold difference as well just between the two junglers because he managed to get that. And looking towards the bottom lane now, in that 1-on-1. Talked about the Poppy and haven't seen it at all prioritized in this series so far, but Oduwamne finally picking this champion up. And I feel like Oduwamne can do more by himself in this game as well with that pick.
But I think the interesting thing is we haven't actually seen it from Odo in playoffs. He played it in the regular season, three games, two wins on it. And we always thought it was a particularly strong champion for Odo. It gives him a lot of flexibility, tankiness damage, the ability to skirmish pretty well. Now we're finally seeing it in the last game for H2K of the spring split. Is it going to be enough? Because Gamsu fell behind drastically in the last game.
He also put so much faith on the right pick as well in the middle lane. And now that's been picked up. There's a slight CS advantage to Fevmin, but it's really negligible at this point. And also that lane is just going to neutralize as well. So we just have to see what it does later on into this game. But right now, that's just a farming frenzy.
Yeah, both of those champions are going to do very well once they become activated in the mid to late game. Yes. But also both somewhat reliant on the rest of their team, you know? Either setting up for a good shockwave for Fabi or providing enough threat to allow Ryu to run circles around his opponent. I think that's Jankos' first mark of the Kindred. And he's immediately going to make his way up top towards Fly, King of First Blood. Is he back?
Well, Fly is dropping low. Jankos, he gets the flash. So we're close.
Oh.
Looping around, there's a ward as well.
I think they might die for this one. There's a teleport available for Oduwamne. He's already started to channel it. They're looking for Reckless and Klai. There's no flash for Klai.
But Spirit is very close. They need to pull the trigger. They need to do it right now. Oduwamne goes in, slams Klai against the wall. Spirit now comes into the fight. Jankos, he's going to use the Dance of Arrows to get away. First blood to Oduwamne in his fifth game. Now Spirit looking to back away, and that's a clean first blood.
Oh, Febby's here, though.
This could be scary. Shockwave is available, but a lot of people are still very healthy. Febby's only got a chalice, not enough AP to work with, and that was a well-coordinated dive from H2K.
And it's all coordinated from the fact that Gamsu used his teleport a little while ago to get down back to the bottom lane. And, you know, we were looking at H2K and the way that they went aggressive in the early games against Origin in the semi-final series. They were very patient, but over-patient at setting up dives. They took too long, and I was worried that that was going to be the same thing. But the problem was Fnatic couldn't group the people in the top side in order to counteract that. H2K managed to get the initial dive off, and you can see Odo was here in plenty of time just to get this gank off. Look, Gamsu, nothing he can do on the bottom side. Mid lane is still running up, no real options there, much better out of H2K, even if it was a little slow.
But as you said, Gamsu, nothing you can really do in that situation. Fevmin was also being chased up by Ryu. I kind of feel like Fevmin going up there caught H2K a little by surprise. I'm not sure if there was a communication breakdown because they definitely could have collapsed on him as Ryu was coming in as well, but he just kind of strolled through the entire team. He's like, what's up? And he had to go to the tower.
Yeah, I think at this point they were just looking
again. Oh, it feels so bad.
Oh, man.
Props to Spirit.
Spirit's just all over this red buff. I mean, you look at that, I think they were just respecting Febby's shockwave a little too much. Right now, at this point in the game, he doesn't have damage. He's got chalice. But they certainly didn't want to stack on the ball.
Support or combat? Do it! Fight!
Chomp cheating.
Winter's bite. Reckless is coming to back up Fly. Fella comes down as Vander stands behind Jankos and gets away. Not true 1v1 support, but I think it'll still count for it. was lingering there behind Ryu, but no real threat to go in. And you know, you talked about Spirit and how well he's playing around that red buff in jungle. Spirit has shown multiple times this year just how big his backpack can be when he decides to show up and when he decides to perform at his best. IEM World Championship comes to mind as the most impressive for the year, I feel, with those Lee Sin games over the course of the few days. And now we need to see if we can channel some of that performance into this Graves game.
Yeah, he was like, I've seen MXG from that tournament. I'll try and do the same thing here. And so far, he's done so well in the early game. He's just definitely straight up counter-jungled and out-jungled Jankos.
And I mean, the meta right now in the jungle favors what Spirit wants to do. Coming in through the first week of playoffs, you know, he was ranked one when you look at the CSD. Not that it's overly important for junglers, but when Spirit starts eclipsing people pretty handily in the early game, you know, it adds up. It really puts pressure on Jankos to make plays elsewhere.
Yeah, and you can see the rest of HTK making a play on the tower. That will even out the towers. So top and bottom on our down, one apiece. Evens out the gold as well. And that will realign H2K as the temporary 100 gold leaders. Does that mean so much as we get to 10 minutes of the game?
They got an extra ward out.
That's it. That's it. I've been warning actually very effectively, slightly more nostalgic throughout most of the games. And Ryu will be gifted the first blue buff. So lane's going to start swapping around and realigning. Well, Forgiven's also going to pick the package up.
Yeah, he's again gunning for that Triforce, and because he's not mid lane, he doesn't really need to go Hex Drink. He's going straight up to that top lane. Double pings come out from both teams, so they're aware of where Forgiven is going to, and should be able to collect this wave. Yeah, he's probably going to lose like one minion, but he's good to go. No, not even that one minion.
But look at what Fnatic have recognized here. As they move up with their duo lane and they hear the package get picked up, that's a big sign that if they hold the 2v2 on the top lane, Reckless and Klai are going to get double TP'd on. Ryu and Odo are going to show up. It's not quite available for Odo, but if they had stayed there, it would have been. In the long lane, no tower available. That's how you lose the early game. It's by pushing too far aggressive away from towers and two TPs pop up. You die, and that's it, because there's no one to help you. You've only got one on your team, and Gamsu's not going to be enough.
I'm clearing up this crab as well. That's another mark for Kindred that's being denied, but Jankos is looking towards the Herald himself and Zogawar, so he'll help him. It should be an easy take. Pillar coming out from Klai.
Exploratory.
Yeah. Okay.
It was actually quite distracting because I was focusing on the Herald and all of a sudden a pillar of ice comes up. But regardless, Klai has access to the ultimate. Subjugate is available. Flash and Exhaust are going to be so important against Kindred. Poppy Rise when somebody gets in their faces. Vander, no Exhaust this time around. But he's much less of a threat because nobody really wants to get in the faces of HTK if you're on the squad.
Also a reminder, this is another game where HTK double TP versus only one TP from Fnatic, something to keep track of as the game goes on.
And what that has meant, in a completely direct sense, is that Reckless just sat top for like a minute, doing nothing, because he was waiting for the wave to push towards him, because he can't step further forward. As soon as he goes in, there comes the double TP, he's going to get ended. But now it's pushing towards him, he can clear it. This gives Odo the freedom to push bottom lane at the same time.
Ryu just pushing out the mid lane real quick into the power and should be good to go. Odawame in the bottom lane as well. And this 1-on-1, how are the junglers doing? Jankos, haven't really seen much from him at the moment. Only 6 stacks on the Devourer so far. Only 1 stack on his passive.
Yeah, not as effective as he's been throughout some of the games. But you're taking stock of all these different items. You know, Gamsu's got such a good CS advantage over Odo. This Klai will run away from Vander. But then the opposite is true when you look at Forgiven and Reckless.
Yeah.
You know, really big differences between the respective players. We use the fair, but then the shockwave comes out, but nothing really further comes from that. And again, I'm just getting a bit too excited. It's game 5 with that third place title on the line.
You're looking at a Ryzen and Orianna at 12 minutes in.
Yeah.
Lots of damage, guys.
Oh, their like kill potential is like 50%. It's like you can't kill someone from like anything above that. But yeah, fighting over wards currently in. Should be Klai taking that one away. There you go. But they do know that the pink ward is there now. Just placing this defensive vision. Even from like games like this, you can see how the mentality of the team is from where the wards are being placed. Fnatic right now is just like, I'm going to place this pink ward down, and this will even give me vision and knowledge because we know that someone's going to be there at some point.
Yeah, Fnatic have had to concede a lot of their own top side jungle here just because of how this matchup has played out. They don't, obviously don't have top tower, so they lose a lot of the ability to play here. Spirit, careful.
Jankos actually smites that one away, gets himself another passive stack, which I think will potentially be important as both these teams are still very even. It's only 13 minutes in.
Yeah, only 13 minutes in, but this, look at this gap that is in the bottom lane. 139 to 97. Reckless is heavily getting outfarmed, and he has to, always step back. Can never really be pushed up against Forgiven here, and Forgiven is just going to utilize that, to his absolute strength. They've got a third of his turret health down already.
Classic H2K, chip away at the turret, people respond, then you back away, just rinse and repeat in a different lane, and then eventually you come back, and that's how it's all set up for you to take another one. Spirit, 3 out of 3 red buffs in this game, but how much does that really matter? Because Jankos has been able to achieve more on the rest of the map.
I think it did somewhat unlock Gumsu, at the very least, that sort of pressure down bottom. So if Gumsu has a pivotal teleport, then I think you can go hashtag win.
Yeah, you can.
But
yeah.
Until we see the Spirit Gamsu impact, it is just at the cost of controlling your own quadrant of the jungle.
Oh, you've got to tie Febby into that, though. The shockwave off the advance is going to be what realistically is going to win team fights for Fnatic if they can hit it. Dragon goes down, and you can see Fnatic. That's the first dragon that they've taken first in a game here in this series. So, that's a lot of firsts. See if Fnatic will be the first of 3 wins in this best of 5.
I mean, somebody has to be.
Yeah. Right?
There's a 50% chance of that.
Just saying.
So that was play-by-play level commentary there, Stress. I expect you.
It was... I meant it sarcastically.
I'm throwing you under the bus. Well, gentlemen, you talked about that big CS difference between Reckless and Forgiven. Not only is Reckless on a slightly slow-scaling champion in terms of the item build, doing Kull as well, and his opponent, Forgiven, is completely that Trinity Force. So there is just such a staggering difference between what those two can do impacting the game. And, with this blue buff losing some patience, just delays reuse of Forgiven.
Jankos and buffs in this game, man.
Oh, it's not again?
No. Dragon's in the game. Okay. All right. Ooh. I freaked out for a second there. That actually... I thought it was dead, and I think they did too. Anyway, Vanda going into the top lane, flying Reckless, they know he's there. But still pushing up, and this is the rinse and repeat play. They go back up to the top lane, get a bit more damage there, and now Jankos is coming in, so they have the numbers advantage, and they should be able to get some more damage on this down.
The problem is Reckless can't ult here because Braum just puts his shield up, so there's no real way of clearing this wave of minions without Ori being here, and look, Fly steps up, gets cleared out. There's the minion wave down, but again, it's a third of the health gone.
Every single time. And now that's so low, Forgiven's probably just trying to take pot shots at it with the Sheen proc as well when the next minion wave comes in. And Fnatic don't have a way to instantly clear out that wave before it hits tower because True Drop Barrage not going to cut it against Braum.
Ryu's already in the jungle. Teleport's not available, so if anything were to happen, he was relatively close by. Tower will be knocked over uncontested by Fnatic, and they're starting to lose further ground in the top quadrant of the jungle.
I like this though, they preemptively moved to mid lane to see if they could maybe siege against that tower because Ryu was heading up and maybe try and trade targets, even though it's inefficient, is better than nothing. But Ryu went back to the mid lane in time and the top tower died too fast, so they couldn't even respond.
Couldn't even respond at that point. Fnatic, is that going to be the tagline for these last 3 games? Couldn't even respond because it has all been H2K.
I'm so happy you mentioned that, because for anybody that has potentially just joined us in Game 5, Fnatic were given all the time in the world to respond in Games 1 and 2 because H2K were not aggressive.
Yeah.
Because H2K played very passive. Then they made a play, it was the wrong one, and Fnatic were victorious. We'll expand on that thought in a sec. Spirit's bad for you.
Turns the corner and does not want to find a rise behind it. Tries to jump over the wall, collateral damage. Luckily, Fevin is there in time to save him, and Ryu we'll be backing off.
At this point, though, he is still fairly squishy when it comes to a trade against the Graves like that in enclosed areas. If you take that end of the line, you are going to get chunked through. And Ryu, as you said, knew that Febby was coming across, knew the shield, knew the potential for the turnaround was there for Fnatic. But they've managed to zone back Odo from this top side. Now Fnatic wants to push top tower themselves.
Clyde clearing away this pink ward, and Oduwani, there's nothing you can do. He just has to back off here.
But look at this, they're trading it for the bottom side as well. Fnatic are going to lose their tower down on the bottom side to Forgiven. In fact, that tower is already down. No, he did just get it. Okay.
Yeah, he did.
I got by my monitor. I turned around and was just like, missed the tower going down.
Right, I was secured by Forgiven, equaled out by Fnatic, still down in gold. And just to extend on that storyline, when H2K turned up the heat, when H2K applied pressure to Fnatic, they've cracked. Games 3 and 4, and we'll find out if it's going to happen again. Yet another inner turret that H2K arrive at first, and will go down nearly uncontested by Fnatic. I mean, that True Shot Barrage really didn't do anything. 2,000 gold ahead, H2K.
Okay, so taking a look at some of the previous games in recap in this general series, I'm going to hold that thought for a second, like, maybe find Jankos, but I think he's good to go. Because H2K have had these games where they haven't been able to team fight. That's been like a mainstay of one of their problems. Fnatic exploited that in the first two games. Then they started picking really good team fighting champions, and they were able to fight back because Fnatic literally couldn't fight them. But now in game five, it's not as simple as just Maokai going in and starting a fight up. So that's something that Fnatic could exploit. But then on the other side, H2K have just been playing the H2K game and taking all of these towers. So there's so much back and forth that makes this literally go either way.
Yeah, that is certainly the case. A couple of you might be wondering, like, hey, that True Shot Barrage didn't do too much in that bottom lane. So the interaction between Gorm's shield is if the projectile even clips the corner of the shield, it will get destroyed. So that's why it looked like it kind of missed, but he actually caught it despite jumping to the side. So again, it's such an easy tool for Vander to just go, nope, nope, not gonna let you wave clear off on this.
Yeah, definitely the case, and it worked out in favor of H2K. Approaching 20 minutes, 1-0, 4 towers to 2. And despite the fact that Fnatic have a dragon, it is H2K that are in the lead and dictating the game. Now, in the first two, or the very first game, when H2K pulled off that double teleport, that's what turned it around for Fnatic. A good team fight. And they've got champions that want to really be involved in team fights. So let's see how H2K played out. 20 seconds to Dragon, 5 seconds to Baron's available. It's a bit early for that one, but it is around the next 5 to 10 that we're going to see these teams focus.
But you've got to look at Fnatic's comp is, yes, they can team fight very well, but once their team fighting tools are down, once the shockwave is down, the collateral damage is down, H2K have a lot more consistent damage with this Ryze, with this Corki, so it certainly depends on how the beginning of the fight goes. Also, you've got a key into the fact there is a Kindred here, so even if that Wombo combo lands, if it doesn't kill Jankos, he's going to keep everybody else alive.
Yep. Well, it doesn't kill Jankos, we'll make him stronger. But not quite, he's not Olaf. Jankos going for Dragon now. This will be the first one of the game. We've actually not really been getting long games in this series. Fnatic, oh, Reckless is going to be leading on charge. I'm not sure about that one, but now the rest of the squad is here. This is dropping very low. Fnatic, oh,
it's stolen!
Over it again, unreal.
TP!
Here comes the TP. They're actually going to go in for this fight.
Let's find out what they can do. The package has already been used. True Shot Barrage flies across all of H2K, but there's just not enough damage. H2K are tearing through Fnatic's front line. Two members of them down already. H2K only losing Jankos. H2K are looking for the tower.
Now trying to seize this one in. They've got the caster minions there. This should be going down. There's nothing that Fnatic can do about this one.
Fnatic at this point are going to try and just stand there, but again, the shield is too strong from Gorm. We're seeing Vander's Gorm performances just completely shut down Fnatic, but in that fight, what slowed Fnatic's aggression there was Febi dying early, and they need him if they want to have any hope in teamfighting. TP comes in from the back, but look at the damage that went down on Febi. Got caught by everything, and the Brawl ult was just the icing on the cake. It didn't matter that Jankos died in this teamfight because H2K have enough to keep going forward and continue to take out Fnatic.
Really good, clear communication in terms of the targeting. Every single member of H2K just dogpiled on Febi and didn't give him a chance to breathe. That was something that H2K could not do throughout most of the series. They extend that lead to now 3,000 gold.
It was also really impressive because they all collapsed the instant Odawame came in with that TP. It's like, heroic charge is everything. And if they can repeat that, they'll be in really good shape, because if a good shockwave gets off by Febivin and the dream happens with their Wombo combo, then H2K could really suffer in these fights, but so far they've had really nice setups.
Well, I mean, Fnatic are banking everything on these shockwaves going off, because Febi, as his second item, has gone the Ravadan. So just like, just give me AP, guys. Just, I need to win these fights. I don't care about staying alive. Just give me the shockwave. Give me what I need to be able to do to shield, to use that dissonance, the damage, everything that he wants, that extra AP, rather than keeping himself alive.
Yeah, the strength of that shield in conjunction with the strength of the armor and MR for True Grit for Graves, plus the damage reduction from Maokai. There's actually a lot of hidden tankiness that will come from the Fnatic squad, even disregarding the Trundle Subjugate. So let's find out if they can get those extended fights. But it's going to be difficult when, yet again, Fnatic are playing responsive and reactive, and there's a Sated Devourer in Jankos as well.
And also, Fnatic are playing on two lanes. Fnatic cannot play on three. Whereas H2K, on the other hand, they've got Ryu with the teleport. Oda doesn't have his available yet, but he was pushing up in the top side. It's enough to drag Gamsu up there in a moment or two, and Gamsu's no TP. So it means that H2K always have this option to look for an engage whenever Fnatic don't have Gamzu's DP available.
Odawane was looking for a potential flag opportunity. He is off to the side, but he doesn't have the flash either. In fact, there's not a lot of summoners up in this game. Only Gamzu has his flash right now. Oh, Forgiven as well, because we've had so many big skirmishes. H2K. H2K.
I got your pulse.
Yeah, Gamzu as well in the bottom lane. Still 7 out of 10, not bad. Currying out this one. And two tank items. Again, in the situation where Odawane was, where he's just this big wall of health that is very difficult to get through, but his backline is fairly squishy, and we've seen it in those last fights. Because, yes, you have those hidden tankiness stats, but Graze has to stack up in the fight.
Yeah, he does, and there's a lot of stacking just in this entire series. You look at how both teams have had later game components to themselves. No tier on the side of Fnatic's mid laner this time around, but, you know, Reckless has had one, Ryu has had one, just this later game focus. Fnatic have let it slip in the last two games.
Yeah, they really have, and it's been H2K that found a gear that they've not found in a while. So, very impressive play. 25 minutes up, Fnatic still only sitting on two towers. The mid outer turret is still being defended fervently by Ryu. And H2K starting to set up the baron plays.
And here it is again. Gamzu has to clear out bottom lane. It's only a small wave, but he has to go down there. Reckless goes up to the top lane to push it out. And that means H2K have the freedom to at least clear and decide whether they want to start this baron or not. They're going to pull back because they can't really effectively do this. Jankos clears out the ward. Fnatic start to group. But again, the option is there.
But is Spirit inside Jankos' head now? Because there's been so many smite battles in this game, all we've really seen in the entire series, and Spirit's generally been getting the better of them. I think one went the way of Jankos, one stack of Raptors, and everything else has gone the way of Fnatic. Even that dragon a little while back. It's all precarious when you try and clear out that Inkhorn, because you might aggro Baron.
It's got a turn on the
side.
A lot of damage onto Clyde by Ryu. Burning through that mana pool, but it really matters because Ryu is still defending that tower. 25 minutes in. And this arms race just continues to grow. More tanks for the Tonks up top, more damage for your AD carries, and I think very important for Reckless. He's got that frozen fist. He's working towards a Blade of the Rune King as well.
Yeah, he is. I'm interested, though, in Ply's performance in this game, because last game, really, Gamzu and Ply were the weak points for Fnatic. And in this game, Gamzu is yet to die. Ply has had a much better game this time. Isn't constantly looking to put himself in the firing line by going over aggressive on an Alistar. This time he just puts a pillar up from a distance. Yeah. He's able to then facilitate the poke that comes from Reckless, and Fnatic possibly could, you know, look to take some kind of skirmish, but the problem is they're behind, and H2K are trying to compound this advantage they've got from having five towers up. They have a good lead in this game to just constantly tear Fnatic around the map until at some point H2K go for the Baron. And then it's on that smite wall.
Or on that smite wall. It's funny as well because H2K actually put a lot of bans towards Fly in the first game and the first couple games with Brom and Alistar, but that's Trundle. He's been performing really well. When he was not on Trundle, he performed worse. So it's just interesting how he's turned up in this game on a different champion.
And also, it gives you some insights into what your opponents, what H2K felt their opponents were strong at, you know? It tells you ban to make Fly uncomfortable, and Fnatic going, well, we're expecting that, so that's why they practiced the Trundle. Spirit takes a big chunk of damage here from Forgiven and Vanda. Nothing really comes of it. Dragon is live. The last time there was a fight and it was stolen by Fnatic. There's no one around from Fnatic to challenge this time out.
The tension is building, but it's not going to be the catalyst, or at least this Dragon isn't going to be the catalyst for a fight right here. Because Fnatic, there's no real chance of H2K getting five Dragons in this one, so they can just let one go. Or they could also find Klai as well, as he's just trying to ward. So they get the flash, which is big.
Very important, because that's the second time Ryu's had a little bit of time to chunk down Klai. Klai being too far forward, Klai being out of position. And Ryu a little early on starting to
attack.
Further attention to Spirit, that's a flash away. Spirit's used the collateral damage, and he's flashed over the wall. It was flash for flash, but no ultimate for Spirit either.
Now H2K all back away, back into the mid lane. Everyone goes back to what they were doing. Just trying to find these small picks, but that's one that's going to open up now.
But what this means is if Spirit has to contend to smite down in a smite war, it is a one-way trip for him now. He does not have his flash available to come back out of the pit, so if H2K are in a situation where they start the Baron and have full control over it, Spirit is giving his life regardless of what happens. So has to keep that in mind. Jankos will be fine. He has that mobility. with the Q if he's in that aggressive position on the Baron.
And you can just feel the importance of this game. It's game five. 3 and 4 was so dramatic. There was loads of skirmishes all game long. These champions have barely touched one of us for the last 10 minutes because so much rests on one team fight, one big objective, or more importantly, one mistake.
Hey, we've seen a game end in 25 minutes. Now we're already past that point. So yeah, one single team fight could just end it. And these teams are rightfully cautious because we're in the fifth game. All comes down to this. There's no safety net anymore for Fnatic. And that's the way they were playing, I feel, in game 3 and 4. They were like, well, we just need to win one. And even if they win, we're still not out of it. But they are going to lose the series if they lose this one. So you can just feel it, as you know.
Yeah, there is a lot of tension in here. A couple of members of Fnatic support trying to just build throughout the crowd here. I hope you're picking that up on the mics. But it is fairly subdued compared to how games 1 and 2 was. H2K, though, they want to start this Baron off. This is what we were talking about. Potentially, the Smite fight to take full control of this. Ooh, no, it's too
Yeah, good. Look, Odo was down bottom. He has teleport available. There was no vision on Gamsu. And he was running towards the fountain, trying to get those home guard buffs. He's got a lot of tankiness in that Maokai. The front line for Fnatic is strong. But they have to get rid of Ryu, Forgiven, or Jankos quickly to win a team fight. He's bounced away from.
Oh, man.
Forgiven is completely aware that he had the timing and he makes it out.
TP coming in.
There's gonna be a turnaround. Odo, he's teleporting in. Fnatic might be caught.
Glacial Fissure comes out. Ryu, he's gonna jump in. And they're trying to get a range, but they just can't quite make it happen. Fnatic a little too far back.
Oh.
Far too far back, and Fnatic just, you know, looking for a counter engage, but they haven't got that shockwave. I think they were taking the break a little too early as that sombrero came out on the shockwave, but Klai now forced to back away.
Is this an H2K teleport from games 1 and 2? This is what we will find out. Ryu has access to his TP, Gamsu does as well. They're locked down.
Spirit
pinned against the wall. Odo's got four members of Fnatic in front of him. The Glacial Fish has already been used, and Fnatic are trying to peel away. Jankos is in from the side. Collateral damage and the re-engage.
But Gamsu's gone in. Ryu, he's dropping low.
They've got the kill! Ryu is down! Fnatic are looking for more! They turn their attention onto Odo, aren't they? As the Blade of the Rune King comes out, that's slowing Odo! One more Mystic shot! It's a kill! Reckless has taken him down! Gamsu is so beefy! Lancer Spike will buy time, and it throws Jankos to the borders! Featherton picks up the kill, and H2K get aced!
5 and 0! Look at the death timers! 40 seconds, and they're pushing in! This is a repeat of game 2!
Fnatic are looking for and the crowd has exploded here in Rotterdam. Back to the game from Fnatic, and they are taking this inhibitor.
They really are. There's 30 seconds left.
Is this
Fnatic are looking for the Nexus. They're onto a Nexus turret. The crowd is on their feet and losing it.
No way is this happening. The Nexus turret is going down, and Fnatic, as they take down this Nexus, they are in sole possession of third place. 50 points on the road to World.
And for another game this series, blink and you miss it. H2K looked for the teleport, did not find it, and got punished for overreaching.
Not only punished, but Fnatic just went through like a freight train. Mid-outer was still standing before that fight, and Fnatic took that, took inner, inhib, and the Nexus.
The faces on Fnatic ecstatic, and rightfully so. What a way to end that series, in honestly true Fnatic fashion, upsetting H2K at the final hurdle.
Tough, and you know it was a call to go forward that cost the game. But the man on your screen right now, Fabi, smiling ears to ear in front of his countrymen, in front of his hometown crowds.
Gotta feel good.
There is a standing ovation in the hall.
Everyone chanting his name.
You could see that on the same time, Odo looking, you know, at a loss for words.
Right.
I mean, Fnatic don't need words right now. They'll just bask in the glory of winning. But you've got to look at that from H2K. It looked to be a good fight. They knew there was no shockwave until halfway through the fight, but something went horribly wrong as they were moving forward. And Fnatic had the tools available as the fight went into phase two. Shockwave comes out, Yankost pulled out, and Fnatic are the victors.
Honestly speechless as an ending to that game, and so many of those games in this best of five ended that way. But Fnatic, they just knew their limits, they knew how to play the game, and they knew what could be converted into a win. As you mentioned, outer turret was up, and he pushed for the Nexus at 31 minutes.
We asked the question, what did Spirit Invading Red Buff accomplish? Step one, get Gamsu ahead. Step 32, let Gamsu tank a team fight and then win you the game.
They knew, they had the game plan. And as we are in the round, Fnatic will be taking a bow to everyone who has supported them here today. Impressive showing. Daylor's got to feel happy, sitting on the sidelines, watching his team do good.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, doing the lap, victory laps of bowing, but for Fnatic, you know, 50 points in the back, it's a good start on the road to Worlds, and they've shown a lot of growth over the playoffs. Certainly, you know, nobody really had them pinned against Vitality to come through. They take out Vitality and showed us good games against G2. And from here, games one and two looking very strong. And a good team fight at the end of game five there for Fnatic is enough to secure them third place.
It's so important to note that Fnatic as a team are a group of players who show up in best of series and in playoffs. That is something that is integral when you look at world championships, because you have to be able to perform under pressure. And as a team, from day one of this year, they have said, our target is Worlds, our target is Summer. They have never once said, we're going to win Spring, we're going to be the... We're building, we're developing. And it's something that they have continued to say and work on all year long.
It's been built in a different way from the Hunian Reignover era, for sure, but they look like a good team now.
Yeah.
And this playoff has really shown that to me, and I think a lot of people.
There are still questions, though. Their drafts have been suspect at times, giving a little away... a little too much away, and then you have to think in that game, Fnatic will breathe a sigh of relief that that team fight ended up in their favor, because they were playing a you know, kind of a risky game again, playing double scalers, looking for a fight that would turn it around, and they, you know, H2K, they got caught out at the right time of the game, and just enough for Fnatic to blow that over.
I have to jump in there and play a little bit of devil's advocate. Fnatic were a good enough team to catch the throw that was given to them multiple times. H2K was dictating the tempo, was in control of the game, was in control of the map countless times across the series, but they were unable to use that control to really command the game. And when they took that one step too far, Fnatic punished them.
And that's the thing, is that step too far was a little too far into the game, because, I mean, we all know that you, once you win a team fight past 30 minutes, there is so much that can go wrong for your team. You lose so much, and for H2K, I don't think I've ever seen a team lose that much off a 32-minute team fight. That's kind of insane. Like, this freight train right through mid.
It was crazy. I don't think I've seen a game end in that way before, really. But Fnatic as well, all the way they were, way they were playing this game, 31 minutes of basically just sitting back, farming, finding some picks where they could. And most of those kills came from that final fight. It was, what, 3-1 before we got to that fight, and they just picked up 5-1.
Yes.
So Fnatic, they were still on the ball. I was like, did they just lose it? Because, I mean, they were, the way they were looking at the game is they weren't actively looking to make those plays. And then as soon as they had it, snap decision, and he just won the game.
Managed to work out for them. Just to give you guys an update, we are busy setting up with an interview on stage. Once that's ready to go, we will head down to Pyrotechnics to talk to, of course, your third place team for Europe. But for the time being, we're going to keep talking about the series and what this means in the big picture.
I mean, I'm guessing who it's going to be with, Trev.
I don't know, but I think with that one, let's find out who Pyrotechnics is going to talk to here in Rotterdam.
Thank you very much, Quickshot, and congratulations to Fnatic. A massive victory. Febivin, I want to start with you because that game pretty much had everything. It was absolutely insane. But after this whole split, so many challenges, so many uphill climbs, how do you look back at what you just accomplished and how do you think of it?
I'd say I cannot speak.
That's completely fair. Give him a minute, maybe.
This bit is a whole new experience for me, a new team. And we have grown so much as a team during this bit, and I think it really showed off today. We managed to beat H2K, which are a really strong team. And yeah, I think we played pretty versatile in these matches. Like, I played a lot of different champions, so did my team, and it was just a good series from us.
It absolutely was, and I almost am at a loss for words in how you guys managed to pull that off after the first two games and then coming back after losing two in a row. Spirit, going over to you, you have grown so much on this team. And I want to ask you about your time on Fnatic and how you have changed as a player.
I'm getting better at English, so we can get better communication, and we are more practice, work hard together. So we improve more. I improve much micro play. So
absolutely.
Now we can beat H2K. Yeah.
Yeah, it was fantastic. And they love you guys everywhere you go. Also looking ahead for the next split, you guys may have capped this one off with a third place finish. Where do you see yourself and the team going in summer?
Next split, I should keep work hard and practice hard for world champion, right?
Ooh.
So make sure next split we will champion this series. Also, I need more studying English now, really bad, sorry.
Oh, it's pretty fantastic.
Yeah.
All right, well, thank you very, very much. I want to go back to you, Febben. You're here, you're at home, your whole family is here to support you, man. Do you want to say anything to them?
Ja, ik ga het in Nederlands doen. Dankjewel voor heel mijn familie die hierheen komt en al mijn fans die hier zijn. En jullie zijn geweldig en ik hoop dat ik hier nog een keer kan spelen in Nederland. Dankjewel.
I think I got that message. All right, guys. Thanks again so much. We are going to send it back to the analyst desk to break it down, close it out, and cap off Fnatic's big victory.
Well, thank you so much, Pyrotechnics. And thank you, Febben, and also Spirit for that interview. I mean, they kind of had to win, obviously, with this huge momentum that was going on for Febben. But in the end, how it all happened, they weren't actually supposed to win that last game if you look at the course of it.
I mean, H2K, Fnatic could have won,
yeah,
but not that quickly. H2K just straight up threw the game. We have to be honest here. Just like, that's how it happened. But Fnatic, they have a good habit of playing passive and they wait for their opponents to make the mistake. And sadly, this meta allows it. You can just be the more passive team, wait for a big mistake, and suddenly Death Timers kick in and your Nexus is gone from tier 1 to Nexus. I don't really like it.
No, that's the problem right about this meta.
Hey man, don't hate the game, you know, don't hate the players in the game.
But Fnatic is like the team that can make
it. Yeah.
You're like the combat kings in Europe, like for sure.
Let's take a look at the replay actually that closed up the series and then netted Fnatic also the championship points. We'll look at that in a second. Here we go.
Yeah, obviously, I mean, Engage in itself is not terrible. It's not great.
I mean, where's your jungler?
Now the problem is also like you miss a lot in this Engage and then you start fighting around towers, so you can't really chase further. And then you start getting caught out. The Ryze has been running forward and his team's been yelling, go, go, go. Then you realize the rest of the team has already gone back and he's now in the front and he goes down.
The whole strength of this composition is the fact that he can dish out so much damage safely with Braum Peel, and the fact if you get engaged on, you have Kindred ulti for the backline.
And that Orianna ult on one person did it.
Both things went wrong there. The Orianna ulti was cool because it knocked people out of the Kindred ulti, but they were disjointed. There was no Poppy flank.
Yeah.
Like, they have three win conditions. Go in, Kindred ulti to keep backline alive. Poppy flank or Braum Peel. None of them were met in that fight. They just zerged in and then discovered that they were getting wrecked.
Yeah, and another thing you guys wanted to highlight, you mentioned Spirit actually at the beginning of the series. And this time around, he absolutely put a lot of pressure on Jankos. That those are the words that I'm going to use. We have a couple of replays of him stealing the red buff over and over and over.
Shook, if you're a jungler, what does that do to you when you see in a game five of a best of five series, the enemy jungler apparently do a wolf start into a red invade?
I mean, I like Spirit as a person, but as a player, I hate him so much. Like, this guy cheeses so much. And like, he's really good at cheesing. Like, he just knows where the enemy is. He's good at predicting where the enemy jungler is. So as you can see here, he's just gonna steal the red buff. Like, you get into the enemy jungler's head, like, you're gonna get so annoyed if your Jankos here, and it might just snowball the game from there.
And that point, I only have this from limited experience in playing some dynamic queue with him and just watching him play. Spirit seems to be very aware at all points in the game where the enemy jungler likely is, and maybe that kind of helps Fnatic play this somewhat passive style where they seem to avoid getting punished most of the time. When you have good awareness of the enemy jungler, surely there is more to it, but it does seem that that's one of Spirit's strengths overall.
Where we see a Peter Diepstraten as well. He saw Pavion winning another game. Must be fantastic.
The Fabi crew.
The Fabi crew. They go everywhere.
I mean, the crowd got everything right. 2-0 first to get them hyped. Then we got to go five games. So two wins for H2K. The last one looked really bad. And then, as we talked about, that turnaround from one bad team fight obviously shouldn't really cost you a game, just losing one fight at 31 minutes. But that's how the meta is right now. And yeah, make that mistake, game can be over.
Yeah, we also have to crown an MVP, and in today's fight for third place, the hometown hero stepped up in a big way. We had to give it to Febiven, 11 kills, 20 assists for a 76% kill participation in five games. He is our series MVP.
Yeah, and this is mostly based for me on the first two games that he played, where I think he had a lot of pressure in the matches, some really good solid openings that allowed Fnatic to get the first bloods. It's obviously a long time ago right now. Later in the series, he was targeted a bit more. But this was one of those series where not a single player, for me, stood out extremely hard.
I think it was very, very difficult for either team, honestly, to pick an MVP. And if we look at this, it might seem a little bit cheesy that Febiven gets it, but honestly, his performance was great, and almost everything Fnatic did in terms of pick and ban was built around Febiven in some way. So obviously, he was the man who had basically all their responsibility when it comes to beta carry. And last game, he didn't really have to do a whole lot. Shockwave on one man in the end, but having a pushing lane was enough to make Fnatic hold off.
Yeah, I agree. Like, in the first two games, he did the Azir ults perfectly on Ryu and exposed Ryu a bit. And here, he just came out of the 0-2. Like, he lost two games in a row and he made a comeback. And must be feel great for him.
Made it happen. As you can see there, we will be moving over to Las Vegas pretty soon for those Immortals versus Team Liquid bout. But first, we got to round up the series here. And with their win, Fnatic have secured the 50 championship points that come with a third place finish, putting them that much closer to the World Championship. Let's look forward to the summer split and what these teams have to do. 30 points is actually the same amount that H2K had going into the summer split last year around. What are your final thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, that's what we have to remember. H2K had 120 points and they got the second seed in Europe, went to Worlds obviously with it, and they started, as you said, by winning this match right here. And then the next split, they did exactly the same. So if Fnatic are not able to make it into the final, they still have a very, very good chance now of making Worlds. Vitality obviously on 10 points and Unicorns on 10 points are a fairly large step behind Fnatic right now.
There's also no team like Origin to come into that equation and kind of stir things up, because they weren't there in spring split. They just came in summer and actually had a really high ranking points wise that kind of shook things up. Right now, 30 may not be enough, I feel, to really get the points berth.
I mean, you got to make the final now.
Yeah, you got to make the final for sure, or just like try and qualify there. If not, it will be the gauntlet.
Yeah.
I just think next split is going to be great, full of competition. Like, every team is going to want to go to Worlds, so I'm looking forward to it.
Who's making it to Worlds? Yeah.
Vitality.
Vitality. Final question about that. Maybe we heard a touch on in the interview as well, and it's something Fnatic said. We're looking for summer. How far do you see them going? And H2K, will they encounter that same problem again? I know it's impossible to say. Take a wild guess. How much potential is there for Fnatic and H2K?
They're still playing this super passive style, Fnatic, and the meta just shifted towards them. I'm afraid when it shifts away from them a little bit that they don't really have that proactive style in them. Yes, there's been growth, but I'm a little worried. However, everything around Fnatic seems to be crumbling down too. If you look at H2K, this lineup on paper should have just convincingly won this match, but they're breaking apart at some of the fundamentals, and I worry what this loss will do to the team. Honestly, health. There are some pretty big egos in there, some confident players. I want to see how that evolves.
Maybe it could benefit H2K, because losing is a big part of the game, and you will always end up losing games here and there, and it's important you can bounce back. If you don't have the players who can do that, maybe you have some of the wrong players. You know, you got to look at your team mentality going into best out of fives, these best of series. Also, if you want to make it to Worlds and be a serious contender for, let's say, a top four, which the European teams should be aiming for looking at last year. So they can probably learn something from this, but overall, I think Fnatic has a lot of room to grow in pick and bans. And I think also communication-wise, we still obviously have a way to go with Gamzu and Spirit. So I think they're going to get better. I just don't think they will become the best team in Europe with this current lineup.
Yeah, I agree with the Fiso statement. I think Fnatic can improve, yes, sure, but I don't think they're going to be number one next split. I think that's either going to be like HGK, us, or Origin, even. Like, they're looking super good, and I'm excited for tomorrow, actually.
Yeah, definitely. We'll touch on that matchup in just a bit. We do want to touch in with you guys, because you've been tweeting heavily all day, because we invited you to hashtag AskTheDesk. And at DunkTK wants to know, who is the best jungler in Europe?
For me, it has to be a Trick right now. Like, he works super well with perks. Like, he gets the efficient down. He knows how to play aggressive and standout player here for me. Yeah.
Any other opinions? Or
100%
agree.
After playoffs, Jankos, it has to be Trick.
All right. Well, we'll see how everything of that evolves. And we got to touch on tomorrow as well. As they get set up over there in North America for their third place match here in Europe, there's only one score left to settle in the 2016 Spring Split. Tomorrow's finals between G2 Esports and Origin for the European LCS Championships. That is the first seed versus the fourth seed. And one of those teams that is maybe expected to come into these finals all the way at the beginning of the split, they didn't perform in the split, and then G2 steamrolled everyone.
It was a surprise for me as well, actually. Yeah. Like, I expected them to be an underdog, and yeah, they surprised me for sure. And I'm looking forward to the matchup. I think Briggs is a really good player, Trick is a really good player, and I think G2 is a favorite.
Yeah, they just bring a lot of pressure from mid lane jungle combination that they can spill over in different lanes. And I think they will perform well in like this best of five environment too. They seem to really not be too shaken up, and they seem to really function as a team despite like coming into the split. I thought like Perks, you know, maybe a bit overrated, maybe a bit of an ego, and I was proven super wrong. Nah, I think he's proven already that he's
oh yeah,
there.
But coming into the split, it was hard to say like, is Perks gonna go from challenger and just become probably the best mid laner in Europe? No one would have predicted that, because like, you always got to remember with predictions, you need to be able to have a reason behind it. And coming into the split, if you said, oh, G2 is going to make the final,
yeah,
and people ask you why, and you're going to be like, Perks is going to be the best mid laner in Europe. You're like, it's not really a prediction.
Someone said that,
yeah,
somewhere.
You can't really base it on that. Like, there needs to be some sort of proof behind it.
That's one of those things where you make 10 tweets with all the mid
laners. Exactly,
and
then one of them will be the right one. You're like, hey, look at me, retweeted. But G2 obviously play a fantastic split. I think right now they're riding so high in confidence, and the meta fits them so, so well. They understand which champions to play. Youngbok clearly also knows how this team wants to play. So going into the pick and ban phase, in some way, I feel it's their game to lose because they've been so good all split long now. So the pressure is on them. Origin has just been a weird story of a team we expected to win in the start and then just slowly sneak in.
The main reason I want G2 to win is because I don't think you should ever be allowed to have a split like Origin and then still make
then
first
win.
Place, because I felt that would be almost insulting to the European
what
region.
What about TSM? They might do the same.
Yeah, you just coaster on, la-di-da, put Reginald in, win the NALCS, and then same for Origin, put in Expeka a couple of games for a confidence boost, and suddenly they win.
They're almost ready over there in North America. Shook, you some final thoughts about that tomorrow's big matchup here?
I think Gamers2 is going to take it. Like, they deserve it, I think. Like, they just performed super well the whole split long, and yeah.
And also thinking ahead of the European representative, of course, for MSI, just to maybe touch on that really quickly. It would be cool to see maybe a totally different representative for you going to an international tournament and see what they can do. Might be healthy as well. But we know that OG, when they're good, they can be really good. Amazing said in an interview recently, just yesterday, I think, we are now at 80% of our strength that we were at Worlds. That actually would be
bold.
Pretty daunting. What do you think?
That's bold. I'm not sure.
I mean, 80%, yeah. It's a tough call. They are playing a lot better right now. Obviously, last year at Worlds, everything just clicked for the team. Also, with the way they were playing it. G2 going to MSI, I think they would try hard more properly and actually learn more from it. They're very, very hungry to keep improving. But obviously, the best team will go.
Yeah, I do have to cut you off because we are almost ready to move over to NA. Our coverage live from the Ahoy at Rotterdam starts tomorrow at 5 p.m. here again in the Netherlands. That is 8 a.m. Pacific. And after we crown a champion here in Europe, it's also North America's turn with Counter Logic Gaming and Team Solo Mid fighting for the top spot over in Las Vegas. You already said it might be TSM.
I think they're going to win.
All right. Chuck?
TSM.
I invoked the fifth. I don't know.
Okay, we will see what happens. And speaking of North America, it is time to check in for their third place match between Immortals and Team Liquid. Thank you so much for joining us, Shook. I hope you had some fun.
You're welcome. It was fun. Yeah. Great country here.
It pretty much is. Well, be sure to join us tomorrow for the 2016 Spring Finals. We will see you then. Doei.
Doei.
Ciao.
Armed and
for this third place deciding match between H2K and Fnatic. The chase is coming in from Fnatic, throws in the soldiers, and first blood to Fnatic!
Kindred ult.
Nice. Kindred. Nice.
I'm moving.
We can end the game.
And Fnatic find the first win, and it's best of five. Gonna chase after it. Spirit has the ultimate. He's gonna knock him into the rest of the team. Ryu's just gonna go down.
Virgil's could stop
three.
Yes,
2,000 health left. Yakko's goes down.
He's all out. They can't get it.
Spirit with a steal.
And in 25 minutes, destroy H2K. It brings me to tears hearing the support from the family, from parents.
I was looking at Fabian's parents. I mean, I was just looking at their reaction because the video was over. They seemed happy about it, at least.
Every solo kill is gonna be the crowd going mental, you know?
Whoa! Imagine I got mental kill.
We can kill now, okay, go. Someone else, flash on someone. Speed it, flash. Yes, we can kill him. I still have ult. Maybe we can take Inkip to that, no?
H2K will not go down without a fight.
Trundle. Casio wants to flash.
Go.
Yeah, we can fight now.
Casio, I go Casio.
Keep going. Can we flash on someone?
Casio, go.
Can we go? I will base.
And ahoy, Rotterdam! We're going to game five.
We cannot disappoint the crowd.
That's slowing over. One more mystic shot. It's a kill. Reckless is taking him down.
Go, nice!
Kindred, Corki.
Nice!
We can end the game.
Fnatic, they're in sole possession of third place. Congratulations.